This week on Maker Update, a rocket made from goop, new clothes hangers just dropped, Google search for your parts, and interrupting your projects. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we keep you up to date on all the cool things that makers are making. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. We've got an amazing show for you full of great projects, so let's check out the project of the week. I'm just gonna say it. I love hot glue. Growing up, I knew of it only as a kitschy tool for crafters, and respect for that alone. But later I learned that it could be so much more. It's one of the strongest bonds you can make between a lot of objects. You can use it to make seals, waterproof things, secure electronics, heck, you can even build with it. And what's more, with a little bit of alcohol, you can easily and cleanly remove it from everything you did before. So when I learned that Joe from BPS Space has a similar love from hot glue, can we be besties? But he's taking hot glue even further and merging it with his love of rocketry by building a rocket entirely out of hot glue. And I don't mean just bonding all the joints with it, but building the whole airframe out of the stuff. I know what you're thinking, and he knows it too. This is not the best material for rocketry. What you want for your rocket is a stiff, light material, and hot glue just isn't that. But by making a mold for the isoframe, he can melt the hot glue into a slightly more aerospace-worthy frame. And by chilling the hot glue, he can get the last little bit of stiffness that he needs. That chilling led to the second major failure in this project. On his second attempt, he chilled the entire rocket body and fins with dry ice, to the point that the entire airframe fractured before it could take launch. And failure is kind of a running theme in this video. If you're going to take on an ambitious project, come prepared for the frustration. But don't disregard the help you'll get along the way, even if the help sometimes means reading the data sheets. In the end, the hot glue rocket was able to take flight and make an intact landing. This is a weird project, but sometimes those are the ones that carry us through a lurch. I also have to shout out the cinematography in this project. I know it doesn't make the project better, but it makes the video so much more fun to watch, and these shots of the hot glue melting over the custom molds are just so lovely to see. Now for some news. A few months ago, Donald talked about this new innovation in AI-based droid animatronics being developed by Disney and Star Wars. Since that video, they've built more bots and deployed them for testing in behind-closed-doors tests with park performers. Not only do you get to see them navigate complex terrain, but also perform as actors, potentially telling their own stories. There's a lot of worry over the potential of AI to change the way we think about work. But this makes a compelling argument of how it can augment the way we work, going from concept to prototype in just a few months. More projects. I know that we just featured a project from Simone Yetch, but I also know that I'm a sucker for a story about a project that solves a simple problem, but still takes a long time to develop. In this case, Simone wants to have her closet close to the wall. Close enough that a traditional clothes hanger wouldn't hang correctly. Which is why she developed the concept of a folding hanger. She could hang her clothes on it normally, but then fold it over before hanging it up so it can sit close to the wall. The original prototype is made from wood, with a traditional hinge, some magnets, and then job done. That's fine, but what if this could be used by others? Turning your project into a product is one of the hardest hurdles for a maker. Simone shares her crate full of prototypes and all of the stories that come with them. CNC cut hangers aren't easy for a hobbyist, but it's tough to get all the tolerances right for a good friction hinge. This stamped metal version is almost good, but it squeaks. This video has a ton of great stories and lessons in it. Check it out. From this video by Make at Maker Faire Orlando, I learned about Digital Fiber. This is a business that offers custom LED embroidery and textiles using single color LEDs in a Charleplex array or an RGB NeoPixel style display. One of the most striking things about their embroidery is the pattern of stitching. It's not just random or stylistic. Because LEDs require resistors, and because conductive thread is inherently resistive, they've built the appropriate resistance into the path of their stitches. It's clever stuff. And finally, it's probably worth saying that Gridfinity is one of those projects that really got away from its creator. Zach Friedman created it, and the community around it has gone absolutely bonkers with it. But at some point, you need to create new functionality for it that might not be scalable. In this case, he wants to create searchability for his parts. Right away, he realizes that this isn't a function he can extend to his users. For detection, he's experimenting with RFID, read switches, and Hall effect sensors. And for identification, there's an RGB LED matrix underneath each grid. Like with so many of Zach's videos, this is a wild journey, and we salute him. And I'm also looking forward to seeing how the Gridfinity community responds with the implicit dare of, I'm just building this for myself. Time for some tips and tools. We haven't checked in on Winter Gaton for a while, but he's recently had an interesting breakthrough in his marble divider design. One of his most consistent bugbears is the marble divider. Mechanically, he can gate marbles into their new path, but they still manage to jam up further up the stream. By moving them through this particular zigzag design, he's able to use the marbles as a spring, ensuring that the marbles at the top of the interface are in the same place every time, ensuring proper deflection into the other paths. And finally, from Veritasium, we have a video explaining the crazy technology of sewing machines. These fundamental maker machines have been with us from the start of the Industrial Revolution. And if you've never taken time to understand how they work, it's time you did. These machines revolutionized a Stone Age technology with a new stitch, but still do it by way of an improbable mechanical ballet. This video deserves a watch, and I strongly urge you to get yourself in front of a sewing machine and make your first stitches as soon as possible, if you never have before. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we're looking at the latest video in Becky Stern's electronics teaching series. And I gotta say, this one put me back in my seat. I don't know how I got this far in experimenting with Arduino and microcontrollers without knowing about interrupts. But I can tell you it would have saved me a lot of heartache if I'd learned it a long time ago. For folks not in the know, the processor on a microcontroller can only do one thing at once. If you ask it to do a lengthy process, it won't do anything else until that task is complete. However, if you use interrupts, you can stop that process and get its attention. This video will give you the basics on how to use interrupts in your projects, as well as sleep functions, so the circuit can go dormant to preserve battery life. All right, and that is gonna do it for this week's show. I hope you've had a great time with it and got some inspiration from it. If you did, leave us a comment, give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe with the bell to make sure you don't miss the next one. As always, great big thanks to DigiKey for giving this show a home and to you for watching. Take care, we'll see you soon.